Thank you. Welcome back to part two of this mini production about the latest butchery by the Israelis against the Palestinians, which were marching toward the historical Palestine. A couple of days ago was the 42nd commemoration of the Land Day. The Palestinians call this the Land Day, and it's about their right of return to the property, the country, the land that was stolen from them in the late 1940s, and the usurping Israelites called it Israel. At any rate, I was about to talk about the existential crisis that may be waiting the Israelis, and that is their defeat, the defeat of their proxies. Believe it or not, ISIS was a proxy of Israel and Saudi Arabia and Qatar and up to lately Turkey, which has changed direction and had an overhaul to its foreign policy and is actually on the side of the good, although I don't trust the Turks personally. I think they are very good opportunists. Regardless of all the wonderful things that Mr. Erdogan has been saying about Palestine and Palestinians in the past couple of days in regards to the Land Day. At any rate, with the defeat of ISIS, thanks to the Iranians, thanks to the Syrian Arab Army, thanks to the Lebanese Hezbollah, and thanks to the Russian Air Force for the bombardment of these savages since August of 2015. Since the defeat of ISIS, Israel has been feeling very tense, and part of that is because the Iranians want to have a permanent presence in southwest Syria, which would make them neighbors of these usurping occupiers. Their base would actually be very close to the occupied Golan Heights, which were stolen from Syria in one of the wars they had in the 60s or early 70s, and another piece of occupied land by the Israelis. And the Israelis are feeling very threatened by the presence of the Iranians, permanent presence of Iranians in military bases in Syria. This would be the first Iranian military base outside of that country. But you have to understand that Iran and Syria have a mutual defense pact, which means if there's a military threat, if there's a war against one country, it's the obligation of the other country to come to that country's defense. So regardless of how you feel, or God forbid how people have been brainwashed by the mainstream media in raising an eyebrow when there was an Iranian presence in Syria since 2011, since this horrible war, that just happens to be the legal arrangement between these two countries. If the Syrians had a contract with the Iranians for the Iranians to come to their aid when there's war, that is the Syrian decision. That is their decision. That is the, that's the obligation that they want to be fulfilled. And Iran has the same thing. If Iran is attacked by anybody, Syria would have to come to its defense. Of course, not much is left of Syria or its defense forces. Nevertheless, it's on paper that they will have to come to the aid of the Iranians. So I don't understand why so many people are outraged by this. It's ridiculous. It really was ridiculous. It's the absolute depiction of illiteracy, geopolitical illiteracy, fueled by the mainstream warmongering media, unfortunately, in this country. So Iranians having lost many warriors, many of them special forces, they're not gonna just pack up and go. They would want to have the presence there in order to defend the Syrian nation, and in order to be able to finish off if any other proxies raise their ugly heads in that land again. I'm working on another article about the Kurdish situation. In this article, I'm explaining the Balkanization of the Middle East, and I'm calling the Kurdish secessionism as phase three, or step three of the Balkanization of the Middle East. If the invasion and occupation of Iraq in 2003 was phase one, and then the entire Arab Spring, which creeped his ugly head in Syria, resulted in the so-called Syrian civil war. I don't like to even call it a Syrian civil war. It was the terrorist war against Syria. It was a Saudi war against Syria. So in that article, I'm sort of and it's going to get published very shortly. I'm putting the finishing touches on it. I'm just doing the final edit and having it peer reviewed. This is phase. If those two situations were phase one and phase two, then phase three would be the Kurdish secessionism in many of these places, many of these countries, whether it's in East Turkey, Southeast Turkey, or Northern Iraq, or Eastern Syria, or God forbid, Western Iran, which the province of the Iranian province of Kurdistan exists. It had always existed and it was always called Kurdistan. Kurds are an Iranian people. They are an Aryan people, one of the many branches of the Aryan tribe, Persians being the majority. But the relations between the Iranian Kurds and other Iranian tribes, such as the Persians or the Sistanis or any of these other people in the current country of Iran, is much better than the relations of Kurds, for example, in Turkey. Of these four countries, the relationship between the Kurds and the, you know, the host country, if you want to call it that, is the one that's the worst is Turkey. So in this article, I'm talking about that. Now, of course, tying this in to the Israeli usurpers, the Israelis are one of the biggest financiers of the development, the so-called development that has been taking in northern Iraq. And I refuse to call it Iraqi Kurdistan. It's northern Iraq. Okay, Iraqi Kurdistan would be a euphemism, it would be a propaganda the title or a phrase. The correct phrase is northern Iraq. That country is still one country. Nevertheless, the Western powers, NATO, including US, of course, they are not, they haven't learned their lesson. And they are going full on with the support of the secessionist group of Kurds. Many Kurds don't want to secede. The Iranian Kurds, for example, are not as secessionist as the Iraqi or the Turkish Kurds are. And now you have the presence of Washington there, two illegal bases in Syria. This is absolutely outrageous how we don't get enough press coverage on this. And they are supporting SDF, the so-called Syrian Defense Forces. And everyone knows that at least 60% of the manpower in that group are secessionist Kurds. So once again, Washington and NATO are steering the hornet's nest, and they are not giving up on their failed policies, and they're going full on, you know, on full speed when it comes to the balkanization of the entire Middle East vis-a-vis the Kurds right now. In my article, I elaborate that the balkanization of Middle East was a long-held project. Bernard Lewis, who is a professor emeritus at 101 years of age, over there at Princeton University's Islamic Studies and Middle Eastern Studies, now professor emeritus. He has a famous map that has been leaked many years now, and it's all over, you know, Google if you just type Bernard Lewis map. They want to completely change the map of the Middle East. Completely. I mean, it's outrageous. And the Balkanization that started in 2003 by George W. Bush, and let's not forget that at that time, the Senator Joe Biden, who became the vice president of Barack Obama in those 8 years, he was a big fan of the balkanization of the Middle East. He's on record talking about that. So this is not a Republican, you know, versus Democrat issues. It's basically the entire power structure in Washington, which is trying to do this. We are wasting blood and toil over there. It's absolutely ridiculous. The Chinese are going full on. You know, they're going, it's unbelievable at such a rapid rate of development. Today I was reading an article that was elaborating the fact that the petro yuan is really coming into existence. And yuan, of course, is backed by tremendous amounts of Chinese gold, not to mention the Silk Road that they're building as infrastructure for trade and commerce between China and all the way to Europe and Africa, not to mention all the countries in the middle, the Eurasian countries and Middle Eastern countries. So they have solid infrastructure backing up the yuan. I'm not sitting here defending the yuan because I believe it's an artificially inflated value, but the introduction of a petro yuan system in which, for example, in this article that I read, the Chinese are establishing a future market for oil This would be a direct threat to the petrodollar system and the interest of the United States. So we have to see what happens with that. My whole point is as we are seeing ourselves getting bogged down in since 2001, really, since Afghanistan, which is the longest war in this country's history, is still going on. It's an opium war. While we're getting bogged down in these places, in these meat grinders, in these places that we have turned into meat grinders in Middle East, the Chinese are going full on ahead and spreading their geopolitical and economic powers all over, literally all over the world. I mean, Africa, if you just study what's going on with the Chinese in Africa, it's absolutely mind-boggling. At any rate, thank you for standing by. Thank you for watching these two parts. Please subscribe to our YouTube channel if you haven't done so already to get regular updates. And as always, keep the faith alive. Thank you.